If you've got your Bible this morning, I'd like you to turn to Genesis chapter 37, please. Genesis chapter 37, and we're going to read from verse 5. Genesis chapter 37, and from verse 5. It says, "And Joseph dreamed a dream. And he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose, and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood round about, and made obeisance to my sheaf. And his brethren said to him, Shalt thou indeed reign over us? Or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren and said, Behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee to the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying." Let's pray, commit our time to the Lord. Now, Father, we love you, Lord, and we thank you that we can come and, Lord, read the word that you've provided to those that you love. Lord, help us to see within these pages, Lord, the message that you have for us this morning. Help us to realize, Lord, that you want to speak to us. Help us to realize that you care for our hearts and where we're at. And I pray that you would help us to be open to what your word has for us this morning. Teach us and lead us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Joseph is one of those rare people of whom the Bible really has nothing bad to say. But if someone brings a charge against Joseph, it is usually in relation to how he handled his dreams. Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren. In any other family, that might be a normal occurrence. Now, the consequences of this dream, however, would shape Joseph and his family's future, much different to sharing the funny dreams that everyone in the family has had the night before. First of all, we need to consider Joseph's decision to share his dreams, to see really whether Joseph did the right thing in this situation. So the first of Joseph's dreams is in verse 6. And this one was set in a harvest context. It says in verse 6, "And he said unto them, Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood around about and made obeisance to my sheaf." Now, a sheaf or a bundle of harvested grain shoots were here used to represent each of the brothers. Okay, when you go out and harvest through the field and collect a bundle, you could call that a sheaf. And each of these sheaves, there were 12 of them in total in the dream, they each represented one of the sons of Jacob. There was one in the center, and then there was 11 around about the other one, and all the ones around the outside bowed down to the one in the center that stayed upright. And his brothers understood this dream perfectly. It wasn't a riddle that people couldn't figure out, and it hit them right between the eyes. It pictured Joseph reigning over them. In verse 8 of chapter 37, it says, "And his brethren said to him, Shalt thou indeed reign over us?" Joseph didn't even use that word. "Shalt thou indeed reign over us, or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us?" And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And so the first dream pictured Joseph being upright and all of his brothers bowing down before him. Now, the second dream took this idea even further. In verse 9 it says, "And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren and said, Behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren, And his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? See, the father here, Jacob, confirms that this second dream extends Joseph's authority, or the extent of his rule, to not just the brethren, being the ones that bowed down to him, but also his father and mother. Now, it's interesting that at this point in Joseph's life, Rachel was probably dead already. And so the reference here is probably not to his maternal mother, the one who gave birth to him, but to the head of the family, the one who was left, the father being the sun, the mother being the moon. And so the reference here is probably to Leah, the mother of the family. Jacob, when this dream was shared with him by Joseph, he rebuked him, rebuked Joseph for the dream, because it implied that his father and his mother would bow down to him. Now, let me pose the question to you. If your child came to you saying, one day you are going to bow to me, naturally you'd be a little agitated, I think. And this is why Joseph is called into question for sharing his dreams. From his father's perspective, he's being proud. He's saying, I am going to be a great ruler one day, and you and mum and the boys are going to bow to me. And he's inflaming existing tensions with his brothers by sharing these dreams. Before we pass our verdict on Joseph, there are two very important things to consider. The first thing that we have to consider is that Joseph did not make up these dreams. These dreams were given to Joseph by God. And we can know that these dreams were given to Joseph by God because these dreams came true in a very specific way. This is one of the proofs of whether a person is a prophet or not. When they foretell the future in a specific way and it's fulfilled, then that person is of God. Joseph's father and Joseph's brothers were upset at the content of the dreams, weren't they? They weren't upset in the manner in which the dreams were shared. They weren't upset that Joseph believed the dreams. They were upset that Joseph had these dreams. That's why they were upset. And yet this wasn't Joseph's choice. Did Joseph choose what to dream? I would contest that none of us can choose what to dream. You might try and dream about something. I even give my kids every night, what are we going to dream about tonight? You have this dream tonight. Does it ever happen? Very rarely. What you dream is very rarely your choice, at least not consciously. The question I think we really ask about Joseph in this instance is, did he really have to share his dreams with his brethren? Sure, God gave him the dreams, but did he really have to share them when there was already that existing animosity between Joseph and his brothers? Well, that brings us to another important question. Why did God give the dreams to Joseph? Why did he give them to Joseph in the first place? It's an interesting question. God didn't have to give the dreams to Joseph in order to make him a ruler in Egypt and save those people alive. So why is it that God gave the dreams to Joseph? Well, it could have been for Joseph's own comfort, so that in the future days when he was going through what he was going through, he could think back and remember those dreams. But I think that it was so that after everything was finished playing out, after the whole scenario had finished, the family would know that God had been in control from the beginning. That there would be a testimony that this was God's plan. It wasn't just that Joseph was treated badly by his brothers, he was sent away into captivity in Egypt, and then there was a silver lining to the cloud, he was able to become a ruler and save all of these people alive. I don't think that's the case at all. No, God intended for Joseph to go to Egypt before any of the decisions of the brothers were made. And the question that we need to ask then is, if Joseph hadn't shared these dreams, who would have believed that God had told Joseph all the way back here that it was going to happen? If all of these things played out, and then one day in Pharaoh's house, Joseph stood up and said, yeah, all these years ago, God gave me a dream and told me all of these things were going to happen. People might think, well, maybe he did, maybe he didn't, we can't be sure. If God reveals something to a person, isn't it their responsibility to share it, to declare it, especially when that person is a prophet or acting as a prophet? Let me take you to another example in the scriptures to push this point further. Samuel was a youth. Samuel was a youth who was given a vision. And he was a youth who was given a vision that would be unpleasant to the people that he was living with at the time. Have a look over in 1 Samuel chapter 3 from verse 11. First Samuel chapter 3, and we'll read from verse 11. And the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do a thing in Israel at which both the ears of everyone that heareth it shall tingle. In that day I will perform against Eli all things which I have spoken concerning his house. If I can fill in a bit of detail there, Samuel was living with Eli in his house and with his children. Let's continue reading. When I begin, I will also make an end. For I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not. Verse 14, and therefore I have sworn unto the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be purged with sacrifice nor offering forever. And have a look down in chapter 3 and verse 17 where it says, and he said, this is Eli speaking to Samuel, what is the thing that the Lord hath said unto thee? I pray thee, hide it not from me. God do so to thee, and more also, if thou hide anything from me of all the things that he said unto thee. And Samuel told him every whit or every bit, and he hid nothing from him. And he said, it is the Lord, let him do what seemeth him good. That was Eli's response. Now, of course, we don't think badly of Samuel for sharing God's revelation concerning Eli, even though it would have upset Eli to hear the content of the vision. God makes a point of telling prophets when he wants them to conceal a vision. We can point to examples of that through the scriptures, can't we? When God said to Daniel, seal it up, don't tell them about this prophecy. God said to John, I heard the voice of the thunders that spoke, but God said, write it not. God told prophets when he didn't want them to share things. And so if we are looking for a rule with revelation, we would probably say that if God reveals something to a prophet, it's their responsibility to share it, unless God says otherwise. That would be the rule we would take based on biblical usage. And I think that it was important for the glory of God that Joseph shared his dreams so that God could get the glory when these prophecies or visions were fulfilled in the future. Joseph had to tell them to someone in order for God to get the glory. Who was he going to tell them to, if not his family? Friends? A pastor? He was living with his family in a foreign land. You see, the fault really lies with Joseph's family for refusing God's revelation. Now, Eli, for all of his faults, was willing to say when he heard Samuel's vision, it is the Lord. Let him do what seemeth him good. Even though that vision foretold the downfall of Eli's family and the removal of his family as prophets, he said, let him do what seemeth him good. God's will be done. Now, I think, as just a little side point, it's very interesting that God gave Joseph two dreams and that the second one came after he had told his brothers the first one. Makes me ask the question, if he saw what Joseph did with his first dream and then gave Joseph another dream, then perhaps God was pleased with what Joseph did. The second reason that I think that it was good that Joseph shared his dreams was that the dreams actually started God's plan in motion. The dreams had an important part to play. We know from having a look at the story and how the story plays out that God wanted Joseph in Egypt. That's where Joseph was meant to be. And God used the jealousy of Joseph's brothers in order to accomplish that, in order to get him to where he needed to be. And this is not the only time when God used the sinful motives of others to accomplish his own will. That's the story of our salvation, isn't it? Have a look with me over in Acts chapter 2. The Apostle Peter, in the great first sermon calling the church, Acts chapter 2 and verse 22, he takes up this thought. Acts chapter 2 and verse 22 says, "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain." It was wicked hands that took the Savior and put him to death. It was people who wanted the worst for him that actually accomplished God's plan of salvation. God was able to use the wicked intentions of man to bring about a good end. And what a good end that was. That was the salvation of our souls. The Lord Jesus Christ died upon Calvary to save us. And he was put to death by those who hated him. If we compare this with the story of Joseph, we see that it was very similar. Joseph's brothers intended it for evil, but God used it for good to save many people alive. Now, in Joseph's situation, his brothers could have accepted God's revelation the right way. They could have thought, well, this is obviously something unique. That's obviously what Jacob thought. He looked at Joseph's dreams and thought, hey, this is saying something. It's not just another crazy thought of a 17-year-old's mind as he woke up in the morning. There was something about this dream that caught everyone's attention, and Joseph felt like he shared it, needed to share it. When the family recognized that God may have been saying something, and I think if they were spiritual, they probably would have, they could have accepted God's revelation. But they didn't. And God saw it coming. God saw that they wouldn't receive it the right way. And it was actually the sharing of these dreams by Joseph that caused Joseph to be taken to Egypt, where God's plans for him would be fulfilled. It was when Joseph shared these dreams that was the catalyst for sending him into captivity. Have a look in Genesis chapter 37 and verse 19. This is skipping a little bit ahead in the story to the time when Joseph was sold into slavery. Genesis 37 and verse 19. Genesis 37 and verse 19, it says, "And they said one to another, behold, this dreamer cometh." What are they hating about him? The dreams that he shared with them. Verse 20, "Come now therefore, and let us slay him, and cast him into some pit, and we will say some evil beast hath devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." What's gnawing at them? What's the thing that's causing, spurring them on in these actions? It's the dreams that he shared with them. Now, obviously, there was a pre-existing jealousy of their father's favoritism towards him, but the dreams seemed to be the catalyst that got things moving. And so when we read through this portion of Joseph's story, our first impression is probably that he was a bit immature and a bit insensitive to share his dreams. Maybe he could have just shared these dreams with his father. Or maybe Joseph did the right thing in a very difficult situation and he was punished for it. Here we can see that it was important for Joseph to share his dreams, firstly so that God could be glorified for foretelling what was going to happen in the end, and secondly so that those wheels of God's plan could be set in motion. And so I think that rather than an immature troublemaker, we see a young man who is walking a difficult path, probably with God. And it was a difficult path. It was God who sent Joseph the divisive dreams. The first dream caused division, and God sent Joseph another one. It was God who was leading Joseph into Egypt via a very difficult path. And so if this is the situation, if this is what is happening in the life of Joseph at this time, what applications can we take from it? What can we learn from this situation? Well, the first thing that we need to learn from this situation is that sometimes God's will for us won't be palatable for others. Sometimes what God wants for us and what God's going to do for us, other people won't like. They won't be at rest, at peace with. Maybe others will resent the opportunity that God provides for you. Maybe they'll be jealous of your gifts and the talents, or perhaps of the position that God has given to you. Maybe they'll be jealous of those things. Or maybe they'll see God at work in your life and they'll begin to despise you for having a walk with God that puts theirs to shame. Sometimes when God works in our life, it causes problems with other people. Joseph stood out because God was calling him out. That's why Joseph started to separate from his brothers, because God was starting to work. Joseph delivered the truth to his father about his brothers when he gave that report of what they were doing with the shepherds. Joseph revealed the dreams that God had given him, and it seems that in the situation in his growing up, he generally conducted himself with integrity from what we read of Joseph's life. But this is where a lot of Christians take an early exit on the will of God. That point when God's will requires them to stand out. What was the vehicle that God used to take Joseph out of his family and into Egypt? What was the vehicle that God used to get Joseph right bang into the location where he was going to use him? The vehicle was persecution. How did Joseph get to where God wanted him to be? Persecution. I wonder, will you take that ride? You want to be where God wants you to be. You want to find the will of God, but will you take persecution to get there? When God says, this is what I want you to do, and you can see, hey, this is going to cause problems, will you still do it? Sometimes God uses persecution to get us to where he wants us to be. Are we willing to take God at his word and follow him in that situation, or are we more likely to retire back into the crowd when God wants us to go somewhere unpopular? We need to be faithful to God's call. And we need to be faithful to God's call regardless of the response of others, whether it's our forecast of that response or whether we see it in the flesh, what others are thinking about us and our decisions. We need to be faithful to the will of God. Let me give a little caveat. Be sure it is the will of God. Because you can stand out in a very extreme position and say, I'm being faithful to the will of God. Look at all the persecution that's coming upon me. I must be in the will of God. And you're square out of the will of God. Persecution doesn't mean you're in the will of God. But be willing to suffer persecution to follow the will of God. Joseph had God's word on it. He had God's revelation. And we need to be willing to go there, if that's where God has called us to go. Second thing that we can learn from Joseph's life in this portion is the lesson from Joseph's brothers. Sometimes God's will for others might not be palatable for us. Sometimes it might not make us feel good to see what God is doing for others. Joseph's brothers were already very jealous of him. They resented the favoritism that he enjoyed from their father. And so it is really little wonder that they were against the idea of bowing down to their little brother. Of course, they already hated him. To submit to him would be horrible. But then Jacob, who loved Joseph, he rebuked Joseph for his dreams. It wasn't just those who hated Joseph who didn't like this. Even his father, who loved him, rebuked him for his dreams. In verse 10 it says, "And he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed?" When Joseph said, "This is what I've dreamed," Jacob said, "Why did you have that dream?" Can you think about the stupidity of that comment? What's Joseph being rebuked of here? Listen to his father's words. "What is this dream that thou hast dreamed?" Does he say, "Why have you shared this dream with us?" No. He says, "Why have you had this dream, Joseph?" That's a foolish thing to rebuke him for. He's rebuking him for the content of the dream. What part did Joseph have in the content of the dream? Well, probably about as much as Jacob had in the content of his dream, where he saw the angels ascending and descending on the ladders. It was simply God speaking to him. So the question then needs to be asked, who had really upset Jacob and the brothers? Was it Joseph? No, it was the Lord who gave the dreams. He was the one that they were really upset with. But they knew they couldn't take it out on him. They took it out on Joseph. It was the Lord who chose Joseph, and the Lord who hadn't chosen Jacob or any of the other boys to be the one in charge. He was the one they were upset with. God was beginning to reveal his will to Joseph, and his family opposed it. We have to be so careful, don't we? So careful. We have to be so careful to encourage and to support the brethren to seek and to do God's will. God forbid that we should discourage someone for doing what God has planned. Imagine stepping in between God and someone else. And yet we can. And sadly, even for a very similar motive as Joseph's family. We read at the end of the passage in Genesis 37 and verse 11, "And his brethren envied him." Noah Webster defined envy as discontent or uneasiness at the sight of another's excellence or good fortune, accompanied with some degree of hatred and a desire to possess equal advantages. What does the sight of another's good fortune or blessings evoke in you? What sort of feelings does it provoke you to when you see God's hand of blessing on someone else? I trust immediately we would have all thought, we want to rejoice with them that rejoice. We want to be happy with them for the great things that they've received. But what if they get the job that we wanted? Do we still rejoice? What if their gifts and their talents cause them to receive more recognition than we get? Do we still rejoice? What if they get what we've been striving for so long but haven't gotten yet? Are we still rejoicing with them that rejoice? We are tempted to envy when we realize that we might not get what they have. Sure, when we're in the mindset of, oh, they've got a blessing now, but, you know, it'll come around for me. What if God says, no, I don't ever want you to have that blessing? can you still rejoice with them? We might have lost what they're enjoying. A very simple example, the old person on the sports team envies the agility of the youngster running around from side to side. But it becomes far more serious, doesn't it, when we come to the family or when we come to the church or relationships between Christians. You see, although we might like to think that we're all given even portions, we must realize that in terms of abilities, spiritual gifts, position, authority, we can't all possess equal advantages. We can't. Others will get things that you won't. Others will become things that you can't. And in the case of Joseph's brothers, we can probably see why. Why didn't God choose any of the other brothers to become that ruler in Egypt? Well, they probably would have failed halfway along and God wouldn't have been able to use them. We can see why Joseph was the one that God used. They weren't men of integrity that God could trust. But in the case of Jacob, by this stage in his life, he seems to have learnt quite a few things and doing quite well. In the case of Jacob, I think it was simply just not God's will for him. Jacob wasn't the one that God had chosen. Why? Because he wasn't the one that God had chosen. God had a different plan for Jacob. Jacob had a family to lead. Jacob had already wrestled with God for his blessing, and God had blessed him. And so whether we're not ready or whether we're not gifted for it, sometimes God chooses someone else. The question is, how do we respond? Without the Spirit, envy takes over. I've felt it myself. Envy just takes hold. But if we realize that it's God who's in control, that His plan for me is good, and that God has not forgotten me just because He's blessed them, then we can handle it. We can get through it. Surely I can rejoice with others when God works in their lives, when I remember that God still has a plan for my life, and a good one. I can rejoice when God gives another preacher a great gift or a great message. I can rejoice when God blesses another family with material wealth or with better health. I can rejoice. I can rejoice in the achievements of someone else's child, knowing that God has a plan for my child as well. If I know that God has a plan for me and it's good, then I can rejoice for them too. Those who envy what God is doing for others, I would go as far as to say, can't be walking with God. Let me show you why. Turn over to 1 John chapter 4 and verse 20. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 20. First John 4:20, if a man say, I love God and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? You see, envy, which is a form of hatred for other people, may not be outwardly expressed. But envy of others reveals a problem with our love for and our faith in God. Envy reveals a spiritual problem. And if there is a problem in our love for God, then we need to realize something else very important over in Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. Romans 8:28, you'd be very familiar with this verse. But there's a couple of very important qualifications for it to come true in your life. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. And we know that all things work together for good. Praise the Lord. To them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose, all things work together for good to them that love God. Those who are walking with God in obedience, to them who are the called according to his purpose, the purpose of salvation. Those who are saved and walking in fellowship with God, God can take all things, whether people meant it for good or bad, and work them for good in our lives. But envy is a thief. Envy is a thief. It doesn't bring us any closer to grasping the blessings of others. You might envy with all your heart and soul, but you won't get God's blessings for others. You might get a counterfeit that you manufacture for yourself, but you won't get God's blessing for others. But the reason that envy is a thief is because it goes further. It goes further to rob us of the good that God can work in our lives. Because it takes the place of love for God, that God who has a good and perfect plan for us. If we turn to envy, we step away from the love of God. And if we step away from the love of God, then God can't work all things for good in my life. The more I envy after the blessings of others, the more I miss out on the perfect plan of God for me. Envy is a thief. And so Joseph was destined to be a ruler in Egypt. He was destined to occupy a great position, but not without much pain. The rest of the family wasn't. They weren't going to take turns to be a ruler in Egypt. God wasn't going to say, okay, Joseph, you've had your turn. Now let's make all things fair and let's get Simeon in here for a while and let's get Judah in here for a while and let's get Jacob in here for a while. No. God had a plan for each of them. And for everyone except Joseph, they didn't get this blessing. The question is not, why weren't they in Joseph's position? The more important question is, what could they have been if they hadn't lusted after what Joseph got? What could Judah have become if he was content with his lot? And the rest of the brothers. Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren. We need to encourage those whom God is blessing and help them as God is working them through their lives. And if God is leading us, then we need to be willing to follow him out from the crowd. And even accept persecution if that's what it requires to do the will of God. And the reason that all of these things can happen is the sovereign God has a perfect plan for all of us. Even in a fallen, broken world like this, God still brings his plans to pass. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we couldn't hope, Lord, to have any better attitude than is in our sinful flesh, Lord, if it wasn't for the fact that you had reached down with your Son to save us, Lord, to touch us and to give us the Spirit that might lead us on to a better way of living. And Father, Lord, we couldn't hope to have a hope for our life. Lord, if it wasn't for the fact that you have a wonderful plan for each of us, Lord, it should blow our minds every time we think that God could use a sinner like me. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be content with what you've got for us. And I pray that you would help us to have the right sort of attitude towards yourself so that we can receive all of the blessings of God. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would help us to understand your word, and may it be the exhortations of the word that linger in our hearts this morning. We thank you, Lord, for this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.